Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's module on the subject of weighted average cost of capital. Let's jump right into it. I want to start by revisiting some things that we talked about much earlier in the course. Specifically, I want to remind you of some key time value of money concepts. I have here, first off, the formula for the present value of a single future cash flow. We referred to this as the cornerstone, keystone, seer stone formula of finance. I hope by this point in the course, you can see why that's such an important formula and why we referred to it as such. I also want to remind you of the formula for the present value of a perpetuity. So you can see both of these formulas on the screen. We covered both of these previously. I simply want to point out, in biblical terms, if finance is the religion, on these two formulas hang all the law and the prophets. Let me try to demonstrate what I mean by that. You'll remember we studied the discounted cash flows model earlier in the semester. I don't want to rehash all of the details and go through the labor of understanding everything on this screen. I just want to simply point out there's the formula for the discounted cash flows model. But look, those three right there in the formula are nothing more than the cornerstone, keystone, seer stone formula, right? That's the formula for the present value of a single future cash flow. Then once you hit the terminal period and you assume that the free cash flows to the firm are going to grow at a constant rate, then you're just applying the present value of a perpetuity formula as if you're standing at the end of period capital T, which represents the terminal period. But then that present value of a perpetuity at the end of the terminal period needs to be discounted back capital T period. So again, that's just the cornerstone, keystone, seer stone formula. Main point is the whole discounted cash flows model, or at least the math of the discounted cash flows model, can be understood simply in the terms of those two equations, the present value of a single future cash flow and the present value of a perpetuity. Similarly, we've covered net present value. Hopefully you can see that the formula, the math for the net present value, is nothing more than the sum of a bunch of the present values of a single future cash flow, or the keystone, cornerstone, seer stone formula of finance. So truly, almost all of the math that we've done in this class all boomerang back around to those two equations, the present value of a single future cash flow or the present value of a perpetuity. If that's the case, then the two keys to success in a corporate finance setting, at least the tools that I've taught you, bond valuation, stock valuation, capital budgeting tools, really, if they all boil down to these two equations, then there's only two keys to success when applying these tools. The first key is get the numerator right. You got to get the cash flows right, meaning both the amount and the timing. That's why we've spent considerable amounts of time just trying to forecast those cash flows, trying to understand what cash flows should be in and what cash flows should be out. The second key, however, we've almost completely ignored to this point, and yet it's equally important. That second key is you've got to get the denominator right. You have to get the discount rate right. You have to get the R correct whenever you're applying these tools. But what exactly is that discount rate? So I want to have a lot of intuitive theoretical discussion right now about exactly what that R is. Well, we know from what we just talked about a minute ago in the formulas for the present value of a single cash flow and the present value of a perpetuity, that thing we're denominating with a R is what we call a discount rate. In other words, it's what we use to discount future cash flows to find what we believe they're worth in present value terms. But it gets called by a lot of different names. And I want to talk to you about the synonyms for the discount rate. And the synonyms kind of depend on what your perspective is. You might either be the investor giving your excess capital to a company, or you might be the company that's asking for that excess capital from investors. So, okay, you got one side giving capital, one side receiving capital. If I'm the investor, I'm going to view this thing as the return that I'm demanding as compensation for giving you my capital. So from the investor's perspective, I'm going to think of this as my required return. I demand this return in exchange for my capital. If I'm the corporation that's receiving the capital, I'm going to think of this as a sort of cost to obtain the capital. It's what my financiers expect from me. It's the cost of obtaining that capital. Both the investor and the corporation are going to view this as a hurdle rate. This is the return above which we've got to exceed. We've got to get over this hurdle rate in order to satisfy the investors. So it's kind of the bar that investors want us to get over, whether you're the investor or the corporation. So main point just from this little slide is that one letter in all of these formulas, that R that you see so consistently in the denominator, that R gets called required return, it gets called the cost of capital, it gets called the hurdle rate, and it gets called the discount rate. Now, you might be asking yourselves, well, but why do we really need to go over that? I actually think if you can understand the labels a little bit, that will help to unlock the intuition. So as we proceed throughout this module, I'm going to alternatively kind of refer to it as a required return or a cost of capital or a hurdle rate or a discount rate, where it serves my purpose to try to help you understand the intuition. So how do we estimate this thing that we call a hurdle rate, right? And I've put up here just a basic formula. You could think of that formula right there as that's the formula for NPV, although we would need to include the cash flow at period zero. That formula is the basis for a dividend discount model. That formula is the basis for a discounted cash flows model. So with just minor tweaks, that formula could be turned into NPV, dividend discount model, or discounted cash flows model. But what we're talking about right now is, how do we estimate that R? We've already talked about the numerator. We've talked about forecasting cash flows and what's in and what's out. Now we got to focus on what that R is in the denominator. Well, that discount rate, that R, is going to fundamentally be a function of the claimants on the cash flows. Why is that? Well, you can see from this previous slide, it all kind of goes back to the investors. Who's giving us the capital? What do they expect? That's their required return. Their required return becomes my hurdle rate, which is also my cost of capital as a company. And the required return, cost of capital, hurdle rate, that's what we're going to use as the discount rate. So that's why I highlighted in blue here, the discount rate is going to be a function of the claimants on the cash flows. So we have to think about who has claims on the cash flows. If those cash flows in the numerator are claimed by the common equity shareholders, then the R should be the required return of our common shareholders. We've got to talk about how to estimate that. What if those cash flows up in the numerator are claimed by the preferred equity shareholders? Well, in that case, the discount rate, the R, needs to be the required return of the preferred shareholders. By the way, that's rare, and we're not going to spend hardly any time talking about it. What if, however, the cash flows in the numerator are primarily claimed by the creditors? Well, in that case, the right discount rate to use in the denominator would be the required return of our creditors. What if, and this is the hardest one, what if it's a mixture? What if the cash flows in the numerator are actually claimed by multiple stakeholders and financiers? For instance, what if it's free cash flows to the firm? Because we know that free cash flows to the firm are cash flows that are free to be distributed to shareholders and creditors. If that's the case, then the appropriate discount rate in the denominator needs to be some weighted average of the required return of the various shareholders and creditors. So this is what we kind of need to walk through, but right at the outset here, I want you to get your minds around the idea that the right discount rate is driven by whoever has ownership of the cash flows in the numerator. That's an important, important connection. Well, let's talk for a second about just the intuition of discount rates. So what exactly is a discount rate? Well, the answer, the short answer, not a great answer, but it's the short answer, is it's the interest rate used to penalize future cash flows. Mathematically, it is the interest rate used to penalize future cash flows. But let's think about this in a slightly different way, again, to try to unlock a little better intuition. Why do future cash flows need to be penalized? Or stated differently, why does time have value? Or stated mathematically, why is it that the present value of a future cash flow is that cash flow divided by 1 plus the discount rate raised to the number of periods? And lastly, we could sum it all up by simply saying, why do we prefer money now rather than in the future. Why, if I looked at you and said, I'll give you $1,000 now or I'll give you $1,000 5 years from today, why do we always say I'd rather have it now? Well, the answers are inflation, risk and uncertainty, and opportunity cost. And we talked about this, right? If you wait 5 years to get the $1,000, it's not going to be worth as much as it is today because prices all around you are rising. So inflation is going to chip away at your purchasing power. That's one reason that you'd rather have it now. But another reason is it's risky to wait to receive cash flows. You sign that contract with me, I might die. I might go bankrupt. You might never see the $1,000 5 years from now. The other reason that you want it now is if you had the $1,000 now, you could do something with it. You could grow it. You could invest it and earn a return. So these are the three main reasons that time has value, that we would prefer to have money now rather than later. But I want to try to show you that those three concepts are actually intertwined and inseparable. And in order to help you understand that, I want to propose a fundamental axiom of finance, and it's simply this. Risk requires compensation. Risk requires compensation. And we talked about this earlier in the course as well. If you buy into this fundamental axiom that risk requires compensation, I hope you can see that those three concepts, opportunity cost, risk, and inflation, are all the same thing. Why is that? Well, we just said risk requires compensation. So the blue circle should be really easy to understand. The right discount rate has to somehow be driven by the riskiness of the cash flows. But understand, inflation is just a specific type of risk factor. So inflation is actually a subset of risk. Well, how does opportunity cost and risk correlate? Here's how they connect. What would be the right opportunity cost for an investment? Right, if I offer you $1,000 5 years from now and you're sitting there thinking, what would be the right opportunity cost? Well, hopefully you would be thinking, well, if I had that money, I could go and do all of these things with it, and this is what I might return. This is the return I might get if I do those things. But I hope you can also appreciate that the appropriate opportunity cost for any activity, when we're talking about investments here, the appropriate opportunity cost needs to have the exact same risk profile as the investment you're considering. It wouldn't be fair for you to say, well, I can either enter into this contract with Colby and he'll give me $1,000 5 years from now, or I could go and buy T-bills. That's a terrible opportunity cost. T-bills are almost completely riskless. Entering into a contract with me for $1,000 5 years from today has quite a bit of risk in it. So you wouldn't want to go look at T-bills and say, well, this is what T-bills are yielding right now, so I'm going to use that as my opportunity cost. That's going to be my discount rate. That would be insane. Those two opportunities don't have the same risk profile. So it's only an effective and reliable opportunity cost if it's got the same risk profile. So very quickly, those three circles, the blue risk circle, the red inflation circle, and the green opportunity cost circle, those things all converge. They're the same thing. So we can think of, but all three of them, by the way, help us understand discount rates. So we can think of a discount rate as the rate that precisely and perfectly captures opportunity cost. That's fine. It's a great way to think about the R. It's the rate that precisely and perfectly captures the opportunity cost. But what that means is it's also the rate that fully compensates for the risk of the cash flows, because again, the right opportunity cost has to have the same risk profile of the cash flows of the investment project you're considering. So those are the same thing. To say that the discount rate precisely and perfectly captures the opportunity cost is to also say that the discount rate fully compensates for the risk of the cash flows. So I want to start telling you about the components of a discount rate. And what I'm showing you right here on this screen, this holds for all assets. It doesn't matter what asset you're talking about. All assets, when you're trying to estimate a discount rate, have three general components. The three general components are the real return, the expected inflation premium, and the risk premium. I hope those make sense. Here's what the real return is. The real return, it's a theoretical construct. The real return is the expected return on a riskless asset, assuming there's no inflation. The real return is the expected return on a riskless asset, assuming there's no inflation. The expected inflation premium is just what we anticipate inflation being over the life of the investment. And then the risk premium is specific compensation for the risk of the investment above and beyond inflation. So these are the three general components of the discount rate for all assets. Many times, however, people will combine the real return and the expected inflation premium. Because the real return is a theoretical construct, there's no pure proxy for the real return. So a lot of times people will combine the real return, right, the rate of return on a riskless asset, assuming there's no inflation, with the expected inflation premium. They will simply call that the risk-free rate. So a lot of times people will say, look, a discount rate is just a risk-free rate plus a risk premium. So our task as we move through the rest of this module is we have to figure out how to get estimates for that. How do we get an estimate for the risk-free rate? How do we get an estimate for the risk premium? So I'm going to use just this model, this graphic, to try to help us think about it. A discount rate is going to be the sum of the risk-free rate, and the risk-free rate captures both the real return, the return on a riskless asset with no inflation, plus the expected inflation premium. So that's the risk-free rate and then the risk premium. So again, the question is, how do we estimate these things? And that's really all we're going to try to tackle when we get to the end of this module. I'll try to give you a really quick example and show you how you can do this. Let's start with the risk-free rate. Theoretically, the risk-free rate is the expected return over our investment horizon to a riskless asset that also compensates for the risk of inflation. Intuitively, here's how you should think of the risk-free rate. At a minimum, returns to risky assets should compensate for two things. This is just baseline. At a minimum, if you're considering investing in a risky asset or a risky project, let's use a concrete example. Earlier in the course, we talked about the possibility of putting solar panels on a person's home. Okay, there's some risk involved with that. And if you're trying to think about, well, what should my discount rate be? At a minimum, what we're saying here is you've got to think about a risk-free rate. And the risk-free rate simply says, whatever a riskless asset's going to earn, you better at least earn that if you're thinking about investing in a risky project. Secondly, whatever inflation is estimated to be, you better at least get compensated for that. So this is the intuition behind a risk-free rate. You better at least get what the riskless asset's getting. You better at least get compensated for inflation. That's the starting point, but not the ending point. Okay, so how do you do this, practically speaking? What a lot of professionals will do is they will say, okay, let's go and select a proxy for the riskless asset in the economy. A lot of times professionals will say, well, it's going to have to be some sort of treasury security. There's debate about whether it should be a short or intermediate or long-term treasury. I'm seeing pretty frequently that people are using either the 10 or the 20-year treasury. There's reasons for that. But you pick your proxy for the riskless asset in the economy. You go and obtain historical data for the returns to this asset. Select a sample period. Maybe it's the last 5 years. Maybe it's the last 10 years. Determine the average annual return to this riskless asset over that sample period. And a lot of people just use that as their risk-free rate. You do have to be careful with that. Let me just give you one or two caveats. You have to ask yourself this question. If I'm using the last 5 years, and let's say I picked a 10-year treasury, I'm using the 10-year treasury the last 5 years, here's the question you got to ask yourself. Do you believe that the yields to maturity on 10-year treasuries over the last 5 years are reflective of what the yields on 10-year treasuries are going to be in the future? Because that's what we're really talking about. We're talking about discounting cash flows that we expect to receive in the future. So we're trying to anticipate what the risk-free rate will be in the future. So that's very important. You got to ask yourself, do you really think that the sample period you're using historically is reflective of what's going to happen in the future? If not, you have to make some adjustments. Now, I will tell you, none of you should ever really go through the exercise of calculating a risk-free rate. Here's why. Another thing you can do to get the risk-free rate is you can just rely on professional service providers. For instance, I pay a few hundred dollars every year. I get this book called the Duff & Phelps Valuation Handbook. Part of that book looks like this. And by the way, it's a very thick book. It's got a lot of great data in it. But what they do is they actually go through the exercise of both using historical data and making some adjustments to try to get a risk-free rate. So you can see right here, they say, all right, here is our long-term, in other words, 20-year U.S. Treasury coupon bond yield. So they're seeing an average yield on 10-year treasuries of 2.72%. But what they do then is they go through the process of asking these questions. Do we really think that what we've just done, looking at past data, is going to be reflective of what happens in the future? And then they normalize it. You know, they do some fancy black box math on it that we're not going to walk through. But you can see down here, they say, look, we actually think you should use a 3.5% normalized risk-free rate. So for any exercise that I'm doing right now, I would probably just rely on the Duff & Phelps Valuation Handbook. They've got a lot more resources and a lot more expertise than I have at my disposal. So I'm going to trust their number. And by the way, that's very defensible. If anybody asks you, what'd you use for your risk-free rate? You say, man, I use Duff & Phelps Valuation Handbook. It's the gold standard in the industry. So that's what we're going to do for the risk-free rate. That moves us forward, though, again, reminding ourselves that discount rates, all discount rates for any asset, is the risk-free rate plus the risk premium. We've already talked about the risk-free rate. We're basically just going to rely on Duff & Phelps Handbook, but I hope that intuitively you get what that is. It's the return to a riskless asset plus what we think inflation is going to be. But this is where we need to spend more of our time. How are we going to estimate this risk premium? Okay, I want to remind you, this is going to depend on the claimants to the cash flows. If the claimants to the cash flows are our common shareholders, then we have to think about the required return of our common shareholders. If these cash flows that we're talking about, the cash flows that we're discounting, are claimed by our preferred stockholders, we've got to ask ourselves, what's the required return for our preferred stockholders? On down the line, I'm not going to keep going. You get the point. The point is the discount rate, specifically the risk premium, the risk premium needs to be driven by whoever the claimants to the cash flows are and what their required returns are. I want to begin with common stock. This is the hardest, so let's do the hard one first, get it out of the way, and then the rest of this can fly pretty quickly. I want you to imagine that you own stock in Ford Motor Company. Think about all the risks that you face as a stockholder, a shareholder in Ford Motor Company. I've listed just a handful here, but you face commodity risk. There's a lot of commodities, whether it's rubber going into the tires or iron ore going into the steel. So there's a lot of commodity risk. There's business cycle risk. We know that automotive sales are highly cyclical. There's interest rate risk because most of your customers finance their purchases. There's recall risk. What if we put an airbag in our car that turns out to be dangerous and now we got to pay for these recalls? There's labor risk. What if the unions go on strike? There's litigation risk. What if our brake pedal sticks and somebody dies and we get sued? And the list could go on and on. So you face all these risk factors. And remember, a required return is going to be driven by risk. That's exactly what it is, right? A required return should fully compensate you for all of the risk that you face. Well, let's remind ourselves of this general axiom that risk does require compensation, but we like to dump risk into two categories. And here are the two categories: systematic and unsystematic risk. Let me explain to you what these mean. It's very simple. Unsystematic risk is risk that can be neutralized through diversification. Let me give you a quick example of this. I want you to imagine that you have a portfolio with a single asset in it, and the single asset that you own is an insurance company that primarily insures houses in the Gulf Coast region of the United States. If that's all you have in your portfolio, you face immense hurricane risk. Hurricanes come through the Gulf of Mexico quite regularly. If you insure homes in that region, you're going to be, and that's all you have is that company in your portfolio, you're facing very steep hurricane risk. But that's unsystematic risk. That's risk that could be neutralized through diversification. An easy way to diversify would be split your portfolio into two. What if now you own the insurance company, but you also own a building contractor company? I hope you can see that by owning the contractor company, the construction company, you're going to be able to actually benefit from hurricanes, right? When hurricanes come through and houses get damaged and roofs get destroyed, your construction company is going to come in and make a killing, Meanwhile, your insurance company is going to be suffering, but essentially what you would have created in your portfolio is your insurance company is just giving money to your construction company. Point being, you can easily diversify away hurricane risk. That's unsystematic risk. But systematic risk is immune to diversification. Systematic risk are risk factors that you can't easily get rid of by simply diversifying. Well, finance, generally speaking, is going to make the argument that only systematic or non-diversifiable risk gets rewarded. We're not going to reward investors, the market's not going to reward investors for bearing unsystematic risk that could easily be mitigated through diversification. We are only going to reward people for bearing systematic risk, which can't be diversified away. Well, if that's the case, this adds some information to our graphic. We know the discount rate is the risk-free rate plus the risk premium, and we now know that when it comes to common stock, that risk premium is going to be driven entirely by systematic risk. Well, how do we estimate the risk premium knowing what we know now? Here's what our basic strategy is going to be. We're going to estimate the risk premium to a portfolio with precisely average systematic risk. We're going to call this the equity risk premium. I'm going to say that one more time. We're going to start by estimating the risk premium to a portfolio with precisely average systematic risk, and we're going to call this the equity risk premium. Then we're going to scale that equity risk premium by the amount of systematic risk in the stock being analyzed. We're going to call this measure the measure for the amount of systematic risk in the stock being analyzed. We're going to call this beta. So our strategy is going to be this. We will define the risk premium as beta times the equity risk premium. Remind yourself what the equity risk premium is. That's going to be the risk premium or the expected return above the risk-free rate. That's what a premium means. So the equity risk premium is going to be the expected return above the risk-free rate to a portfolio with precisely average systematic risk, and then we're going to multiply that by the amount of systematic risk in the stock that we are analyzing. We're going to call that measure beta. If we do that, then the discount rate for common stock is going to be the sum of the risk-free rate plus the product of the equity risk premium times the beta. Just a little note, that formula for discount rate holds for all assets, and the only thing that would change there is you move to different assets. So if you're trying to estimate a discount rate for Nike versus Delta Airlines, the only thing that's going to change is the beta. The risk-free rate should be the same for all assets, right? That's the expected return on a theoretically riskless asset plus the expected inflation premium. That's not going to change whether you're talking about Delta or talking about Nike. Same thing for the equity risk premium, because the equity risk premium is the expected return above the risk-free rate to a perfectly diversified portfolio with average systematic risk. That's not going to change whether you're talking about Nike or Delta. The only thing that's going to change between Nike and Delta is that beta. Okay, so here we find ourselves, right? There's our graphic. That's kind of our schema. And it's going to look like this now that we've actually defined it, right? So the discount rate, we're going to call that the expected return on a specific asset, maybe the expected return on Home Depot, is going to be the risk-free rate plus Home Depot's beta times the equity risk premium. But this leaves us with two questions. How do we estimate that equity risk premium, and how do we estimate that beta? So let's move forward. Let's talk about estimating the equity risk premium. Theoretically, as we just mentioned, this is the expected return above the risk-free rate. Why above the risk-free rate? What are you doing? We've already captured the risk-free rate. What we want in the equity risk premium is the expected return above and beyond the risk-free rate. Therefore, theoretically, the equity risk premium will be the expected return above the risk-free rate to a perfectly diversified portfolio. Why a perfectly diversified portfolio? Because a perfectly diversified portfolio completely neutralizes unsystematic or diversifiable risk. So the only thing left in a perfectly diversified portfolio is systematic, non-diversifiable risk. And this just walks you through that, right? Perfectly diversified portfolio has no unsystematic risk, and that perfectly diversified portfolio should have precisely average systematic risk. Try to understand this. If it's a perfectly diversified portfolio, which means you've basically got all of the tradable assets in the known world, you have no unsystematic risk, and each of those assets in that perfectly diversified portfolio have their own level of systematic risk. So you've dumped into your portfolio all of these assets with their own level of systematic risk. Well, when you take that all together, the portfolio itself is going to have average systematic risk. The return to that perfectly diversified portfolio should be entirely driven by average systematic risk. The return to that portfolio, less the risk-free rate, is going to be the premium for bearing average systematic risk, and we're going to call that the equity risk premium. Practically speaking, how are you going to do this? You got to select a proxy for the perfectly diversified portfolio. Again, according to financial theory, financial economic theory, that should include all tradable assets in the world. You'll never be able to find that market. Feel free to use a lot of times people use a broad diversified stock portfolio like the Russell's 3000. There's actually a lot of finance research that says you can probably get away with just picking the S&P 500. If you really want to go big, then you need to pick a global index. You might be sitting there saying, I don't understand. You're saying it's supposed to be the portfolio of all tradable assets in the world, and then you tell me it can just be the S&P 500? That doesn't make any sense. Well, theoretically, to do it right, you should pick the broadest index you can get, a broad global index. But what we found empirically is that there's such high correlation between the S&P 500 and the broad global index that you don't get wildly different answers regardless of which one you pick. Anyways, you need a proxy for the perfectly diversified portfolio, and you need a proxy for the risk-free rate. You got to select a sample period. How far back will you go, and what will your frequency be? Will you do annual returns, monthly returns, daily returns? Once you make those decisions, you collect the return data to the market and the risk-free rate. Calculate the difference between the market and the risk-free rate. Once you've done that, you can calculate the average equity risk premium over your sample period. Then you need to annualize the average equity risk premium. Don't ever do this. Just like with the risk-free rate, the Duff & Phelps Valuation Handbook does this for you. You can also just rely on the Duff & Phelps Valuation Handbook to get the equity risk premium. You can see down here at the bottom, the Duff & Phelps recommended equity risk premium was developed in relation to and should be used with a 3.5% normalized risk-free rate. So what are we saying? Equity risk premium, according to Duff & Phelps, at least in the most recent version that I saw, they have an equity risk premium of 5.5% and they have a risk-free rate of 3.5%. So we can come back here and we can look right here and we can say, oh, wow, we're making progress. We know Duff & Phelps says the risk-free rate right now should be 3.5%. Equity risk premium should be 5.5%. The only thing that's missing, and again, we're still talking about common stock here. The only thing that we're missing is the beta. But let's do a quick GPS check. I know that this can be new and this can be a little bit complicated for us, so let's make sure we understand. What we said previously was that for any asset, the discount rate, which is a function of risk, and you can also think of it as an opportunity cost, the discount rate for any asset has three general components. The real return, which is the expected return to a riskless asset with no consideration of inflation. The second component is the expected inflation premium, and the third component is the risk premium. We said that most people combine that real return and the expected inflation premium, that's the risk-free rate. Add that to the risk premium, you get the discount rate. We define the risk premium for a common stock as the beta times the equity risk premium. Remember, the equity risk premium is the expected return above and beyond the risk-free rate to a perfectly diversified portfolio, which should have no unsystematic risk and perfectly average systematic risk. And then the beta is going to be the amount of systematic risk in the specific stock you're trying to analyze. Therefore, our discount rate is going to be defined as the risk-free rate plus beta times the equity risk premium. Another way to think about it is right here. The expected return on any asset or any stock is the risk-free rate plus the beta of that stock multiplied against the expected return of that perfectly diversified, what we call market portfolio. That's what we refer to it as. So all you're seeing in the brackets there is the expected return to that market portfolio minus the risk-free rate. That is the equity risk premium inside the brackets. And I want to reiterate, if you use that formula, the only thing that changes across assets is the beta. So you can rely on that Duff & Phelps valuation handbook for both the risk-free rate and the equity risk premium. Okay, so how do we estimate the equity risk premium? Check mark. Now what we have to talk about is how do you estimate beta? Okay, theoretically, beta is the amount of systematic risk present in an asset where average systematic risk takes the value of one. And I'll try to show you why we need that condition to hold. We need beta to be defined such that if an asset has average systematic risk, it has to take the value of one. Here's the intuition. Only systematic risk is rewarded. We now have an estimate of the risk premium for average systematic risk. We call that the equity risk premium. Now we need to scale that measure. So we need a scaled measure of systematic risk where the average equals one. If we get that, then our discount rate can just be calculated with that formula that I've shown you three or four times now. So we're almost there. And again, this is the hardest part of what we need to talk about. A little bit more intuition here. If the market portfolio is perfectly diversified, then returns to the market are solely driven by systematic risk. And if that's the case, here's the logic leap that I need you to take right now. If that's the case, then the returns to that perfectly diversified portfolio, what we call the market portfolio, are a perfect inverse proxy for systematic risk. Let me say that again. The returns to the market portfolio should be a perfect inverse proxy for systematic risk. Why? Because there's nothing else driving the returns. There is no undiversified risk. That's all been diversified away. The only thing driving the returns is the systematic risk, and we know there's an inverse relationship between risk and return. What I mean by that, I have to be careful. We know that as risk goes up, prices drop. That's what we know. So what would the correlation between the returns for a specific stock and the returns on that market portfolio, what would the correlation signal? If you measured the correlation between Home Depot's returns and the returns to the market portfolio, what would you have? That correlation would be a measure of the systematic risk in Home Depot stock. Then all you would need to do is scale that so we could have an average systematic risk equal to one. So what we're going to do is we're going to basically find the correlation between a stock's returns and the market's returns, and then we're going to scale that correlation so that the average equals one, and that'll give us the measure that we seek. I think it's easiest to understand this graphically. So I've got three assets on the board here. I've got stock I in the teal or the blue color, stock J in the red color, and then the market portfolio, the perfectly diversified portfolio, is green. So look at that for a second. Green is the market, red is stock J, blue is stock I. What can you infer about the systematic risk of stock I and stock J from the graph? Again, we're assuming that only systematic risk gets rewarded because every other kind of risk could be diversified away. If you don't love that assumption, don't worry about it. We can talk about it in class. Well, hopefully you can see that clearly when the market goes up, stock J goes up by much more, and symmetrically, when the market goes down, stock J goes down by much more. So if that green line represents average systematic risk, we can infer that stock J, the red line, has much higher systematic risk. It's much more volatile when there's movement. Conversely, the blue line, stock I, is muted. When the green line goes up, when the market goes up, stock I does not go up by as much. When the market falls, stock I does not fall by as much. It's less sensitive. So our conclusion would be that stock J, the red, has more systematic risk than the market, which again, the market has average systematic risk. And stock I, the red stock, must have less systematic risk than the market. But we need a quantifiable measure of systematic risk for stock I that locks average systematic risk at exactly one. Why is that? why do we need the beta to be 1 if a stock has average systematic risk? Here's why. We've been working with this top formula quite a bit. That's how we're going to calculate required return for a stock. It's going to be the risk-free rate plus the product of the beta times the equity risk premium. Well, what if what we're trying to do is find the required return for the market? So we're trying to find the expected return for the market. We have to have beta equal to 1 for this formula to work, because we already know that the right discount rate for the market would be the risk-free rate plus the equity risk premium. By definition, the equity risk premium is the return to the market above and beyond the risk-free rate. So what would be the right discount rate for the market is just add the equity risk premium to the risk-free rate. But this formula only works then if beta equals 1 for the market. We know the market has average systematic risk. If beta is 1, then this product just turns into the equity risk premium. We add the equity risk premium to the risk-free rate, and we get the discount rate that we know is right for the market by a tautology. So how are we going to get it so that beta takes on the value of 1 for the market, and therefore it would take on the value of 1 if a stock had average systematic risk? So what we're going to do is we're going to regress the returns to the stocks onto the returns to the market. So for instance, the red dots represent stock J, right, the red line back here. And on the x-axis, we've just created a scatter plot. So this is the return to the market on the x-axis. On the y-axis is the return to stock J. So at any given point in time, we might say, okay, right there is the return to the market. There's the return to stock J. Let's go map that on our scatter plot. So we would go and find the return to the market, and then we would find the corresponding return to stock J. So we're just doing a scatter plot. Returns to the market on the x-axis, returns to stock I and J on the y-axis. Then we calculate a regression. And you can see, not surprisingly, that the slope of the line that best fits the scatter plot of stock J, which again, returns to the market on the x-axis, returns to the stock on the y-axis, we run a regression and we see that the slope coefficient is 2. What does that tell us? Well, if average systematic risk is 1, and this stock has a beta or a slope coefficient of 2, what does that tell us? This stock has about twice the systematic risk of the market. Well, I think our eyeball test kind of verifies that, yeah? When the green line goes up, the red line goes up about by twice as much. When the green line goes down, the red line goes down by about twice as much. We could do the same thing with the blue line. The blue line gets a slope coefficient of about 0.5, which means it has about half the level of the average systematic risk in the market portfolio. Well, again, the eyeball test kind of confirms this. Yeah, when the green line goes down, blue goes down by about half as much. When the green line goes up, blue line goes up by about half as much. So this is the way that we do it. You create a scatter plot, returns to the market on the x-axis, return to the stock on the y-axis, estimate a regression. The slope coefficient in that regression is going to be our beta. I can prove to you this is right, because what if you did this for the market? What if you ran a regression of the market? So the return on the market is on the x-axis, the return on the market is on the y-axis. You run the line through that, you're going to get y equals x. The slope coefficient is 1. So this is exactly the measure that we want, and that's going to be the technique. So how do we do it? Well, you're going to select a proxy for the market portfolio, select a sample period, meaning how far back and what's the frequency, monthly data, daily data, yearly data. Then you're going to collect return data to the market and to stock I. Then you're going to estimate the following regression. On the left-hand side of the regression is going to be the return to the stock. On the right-hand side is going to be return to the market. Estimate that regression, and the beta or the slope coefficient from that regression will become the beta when you're estimating the cost of capital or the required return. But you're just doing this graphically. You're just creating a scatter plot, estimating the regression, and taking the slope coefficient. That's exactly what you're doing. So putting it all together, again, we're talking about common stock. What you're going to do is you're going to calculate the discount rate as the sum of the risk-free rate plus the risk premium. Risk premium is solely a function of systematic risk. So the way we're going to estimate that is we're going to estimate an equity risk premium, the expected return above and beyond the risk-free rate to a perfectly diversified portfolio. Then we're going to scale that by the amount of systematic risk in the stock, which is estimated by beta. This is known as the capital asset pricing model. People just refer to it as CAPM. CAPM is a common method of estimating discount rates for common stock. That's as far as I'm going to take it with common stock. We could actually spend a lot more time talking about CAPM, how reliable it is, the problems with CAPM. You can lever and unlever beta. You can calculate an adjusted beta. But this is an intro class, so I'm going to cut it off right there. Okay, so we've made huge progress. That was by far the hardest thing that we need to cover. So we started out this module by saying, how do we estimate the hurdle rate? We've got to get R right. And we made the point intuitively that it should be driven by the claimants on the cash flows. So if you're talking about cash flows that are claimed by common shareholders, we're going to use the capital asset pricing model as we just described. What about preferred stock and debt? Well, I'm going to wave my hands at preferred stock because it's not very common. To calculate the hurdle rate for preferred stock, most people just use the dividend yield. So you take the dividend over the price of the preferred stock, and that's what you would use as the required return. That's all I'm going to say about it. We're going to spend a lot more time, though it doesn't take nearly as much time as CAPM, to talk about the required return to our creditors. So what if the cash flows up here are actually cash flows that are going to creditors? Well, again, we remind ourselves that any required return has these three basic components: real return plus expected inflation premium plus risk premium. We combine those two to get the risk-free rate. But you'll recall from earlier in the term and earlier in the course, we talked about the three big risk factors, and I want to remind you, all required returns should be driven by the risk or the uncertainty of the cash flows. Well, we talked about this earlier in the semester. What were the major risk factors that bonds face? Inflation, which we've already captured, plus default risk, interest rate risk. Those are the big three. And then there's a bunch of others, right? Liquidity risk, call risk, geopolitical risk, tax risk, and several others. We already talked about all of this. There's a measure that captures all of that. It's called yield to maturity. This is precisely what the yield to maturity on a bond is. A yield to maturity on a bond is the return that the market demands as a compensation for all of the risk that you face. So you don't have to do any calculations on this. Now, technically, if you're going to use this as a cost of debt or the required return when you're trying to figure out a discount rate, you should include the cost of issuance, but this is often unknown or immaterial. So most people just use as their cost of debt or their required return to creditors the weighted average yield to maturity on long-term bonds. This is actually very easy to get. I'll show you an example here in just a few minutes. You can go to a website and you'll be able to find all the yields to maturity on their long-term bonds. You're supposed to use the market value of the bonds to find the weighted average, but most people just use the book value because the book value for most debt is very close to the market value. So even though you should always be using market values, most people just use the book value of debt to figure out the weighted average of the yield to maturity. Now, if the outcome is unjustifiably low or high, you may need to use some workarounds. This is, again, an intro class, so I'm going to kind of cut it short, and I'm not going to show you all the workarounds. For those of you that want more information on this, I would direct you to the Advanced Corporate Finance elective that you can take in the second year. All right, we've made tremendous progress. So how do we estimate the hurdle rate? Well, again, it depends on the claimants of the cash flows. If it's common shareholders, we're going to use CAPM. If it's preferred shareholders, we're going to use the dividend yield. If it goes to creditors, we're going to use the weighted average yield to maturity on long-term bonds. But what we haven't talked about is, what if the cash flows go to mixed claimants? What if this is free cash flows to the firm? And in that case, if it's free cash flows to the firm, what does that mean? That means that the cash flows go to common shareholders, preferred shareholders, and creditors. If that's the case, then the R, the discount rate, needs to be some weighted average of the required return to all of these investors. So coming back here, if the cash flows go to common shareholders, preferred shareholders, and creditors, we're going to need to use a weighted average of all of these required returns to get the right discount rate in that case. So the weighted average cost of capital is the label that we give to this thing. The weighted average cost of capital, or simply WACC, is just going to be the weighted average of the cost of equity, the cost of debt, and the cost of preferred stock, with one important, very important adjustment that you need to make. We need to consider the effect of taxes. So here's what the formula is going to look like. Then let me explain the little tweak here. So the weighted average cost of capital is going to be the cost of equity, which I'm using RE to denote, the cost of debt, RD, and the cost of preferred stock, but then you have to weight it, and you have to take into account taxes. So what you're going to do is you're going to calculate the market value of equity over the total enterprise value, which is equity plus preferred stock plus debt. So that's the percentage of the firm that's attributed to equity right now. That's your weight on the cost of equity. Take the market value of debt over the enterprise value. That's the percentage of the enterprise value attributed to debt. That will become your weight for the cost of debt, and then you multiply it by 1 minus the marginal tax rate. I'll show you why shortly. Lastly, the value of preferred stock over the enterprise value. That's the percentage of the enterprise value attributable to preferred stock. That becomes our weight for the required return on preferred stock. So this is the formula for WACC. It's nothing more than the weighted average of the after-tax required returns to all of our financiers. Let's talk for a second about this little term right here, the 1 minus the marginal tax rate. Remember, interest expense is tax deductible, but dividends are not. So for every dollar a company pays in interest, its taxable income decreases by $1. And for every dollar that a company's income goes down, it saves $1 times the marginal tax rate. So the actual cost of debt is not to the firm. The actual cost of debt to the firm is not the required return to the shareholder because of the effect of taxes. So that's one of those moments where the required return is not the same as the cost of capital. Specifically, the cost of debt is the required return to our creditors times 1 minus the marginal tax rate. Let me show it to you mathematically. If a company has a market value of $100,000 of debt with a yield to maturity and coupon rate both equal to 10% and a marginal tax rate of 35%, well, the annual interest expense is 10%, but that means that the net income gets reduced by $10,000. So if we're paying 10% or $10,000, that reduces our net income. That means that we're going to save 35% of that $10,000 on taxes. So that $10,000 tax shield results in $3,500 of savings. So what's the actual after-tax interest expense? Well, yeah, we pay the $10,000, but then we save $3,500 in taxes. So the actual after-tax interest expense is $6,500. Well, what does that mean? The actual after-tax cost of debt is the $6,500 net debt expense over the $100,000, which is 6.5%. Or another way of saying that is we could have taken our nominal cost of debt or the required return to our creditors times 1 minus the marginal tax rate, and that would have also gotten us to 6.5%. So that's why the formula is what it is. This also solves a riddle for us. You'll remember that in a previous module we talked about what cash flows should be in and what cash flows should be out. And I vehemently argued that when you're talking about financing costs, they should be out, right? What we said is if you're making a big purchase and you're financing part of it with debt, just include the actual purchase price as a negative cash flow at period zero. Some of you were perplexed though, but what about the tax benefits? I think I convinced you that the present value of the loan using the loan rate is just equal to the initial outflow at period zero. I think I convinced you of that. But some of you, I think rightly, were concerned about the tax shield. This is, and I waved my hands at it before. What I said was, we're going to capture the tax benefits in the denominator. Here is the moment. I want you to see that we're capturing the tax benefits in the denominator, right? What we're doing is we're lowering the cost of debt by that marginal tax rate. By lowering the cost of debt, that's going to lower the WACC. And if you lower the WACC, I need you to think about this mathematically. If you lower the WACC, you're lowering the discount rate in the denominator. And if you lower the discount rate in the denominator, that's going to make your present value higher. It's going to make your NPV higher. So I want to give you an example of how to actually calculate the weighted average cost of capital. Again, there it is right there. There's the weighted average cost of capital. It might be good for us actually to have that as we go and do this example. So I'm going to do this for Southwest Airlines. There's our formula for WACC. I'm going to drop out preferred stock. A lot of times we just ignore preferred stock. It's either not there or it's so trivial that it's immaterial. So we're going to calculate the cost of equity using CAPM. And if you remember, CAPM equals the risk-free rate plus the beta times the equity risk premium. Okay, so we'll do this very quickly. Just want to give you a demonstration. So I need to get the market value of equity and the market value of debt because that's going to give us our enterprise value and that'll be the weights. So I'm actually going to go to Finance Yahoo, and I'm going to put in Southwest Airlines here. Their ticker symbol is LUV. And you're going to see that the market cap will pull up here once we get that quote. So the market cap is $33.725 billion. And we're going to also need the market value of debt. I'm actually just going to pull that straight from the balance sheet. So I'm going to go to the SEC, and I'm going to get the 10K for Southwest Airlines. So again, we're just doing an Edgar search is what that's called. So Southwest Airlines, I'm going to look in their most recent 10K. Now, reminder, you want to use market value, and there is a way to get market value, but almost everybody shortcuts this and just goes to the balance sheet because, again, for most companies, the book value of debt is going to be very close to the market value. You only want, however, interest-bearing debt. I should have said that. So as we come down here to interest-bearing debt, there's current maturities on long-term debt. That looks like it's $348 million, if I've got the scale right. Yeah. So $348 million plus long-term debt less current maturities is $332. So, okay, we're going to need $3.32 plus the $0.348. Okay, so that's the amount of debt they have. So from there, we'll be able to calculate enterprise value. For risk-free rate, I'm going to use the Duff & Phelps like we looked at during the presentation. I'm going to use 3.5% for the Duff & Phelps risk-free rate, and I'm also going to rely on Duff & Phelps for my equity risk premium. So there's our risk-free rate and our equity risk premium. The only other thing that we need for the cost of equity or the required return for our shareholders under the CAPM model is beta. So if you come back to Finance Yahoo, you'll actually see that they give you this. It says that Southwest Airlines has a beta of 1.22. So we'll put that into our model right here, 1.22. So now we can get the cost of equity, which is simply the risk-free rate plus the product of the beta times the equity risk premium. Okay, so there's our cost of equity. Now to get our cost of debt, we want to get the weighted average yield to maturity on long-term debt. Best place to get this is a website called finra.org. When you go to FINRA, just want to click on investors. And then over on the right-hand side, you want to click on Market Data Center. And then over on the left, you're going to see Bonds. And then once you come to Bonds, you want to do a search, and you can type in the ticker symbol for Southwest Airlines. Okay, now we want to use long-term bonds. Why do we want to use long-term bonds? We want to use long-term bonds because, especially when you look at a lot of our formulas, so let me take you back to what we were talking about earlier. If you look, for instance, at the formula for the discounted cash flows model, this model, the discounted cash flows model, actually has an infinite investment horizon. Because in the discounted cash flows model, you're assuming that at some point cash flows grow at a steady rate in perpetuity. That right there is the present value at the end of period capital T of the free cash flows to the firm growing indefinitely. So our investment horizon in our model is actually indefinite. So you want your discount rate to capture that. So you actually have an indefinite investment horizon. So we want long-term bonds. For Southwest Airlines, I see actually none of them that are terribly long-term. I see two that mature in 2027. And they have a yield to maturity of 3.99 and 3.81. So I'm going to take the average of that, and then I'm going to point out that this will create problems for us. Okay, so that's going to be our cost of debt for Southwest Airlines. That is too low. I can tell you that's too low because it's way too close to the risk-free rate, and Southwest Airlines is not a AAA-rated entity. If you look at the ratings here, you can see that Southwest Airlines is kind of a mid-grade, investment-grade corporation. So I might be okay with 3.9% if we were talking about a AAA company, but they're not AAA. So it's too low. I'm going to acknowledge that, but I'm going to roll forward, and maybe in class we'll talk about what you can do if you get a WACC that's too low. For marginal tax rate, for now, I'm going to use 35%. Really, you should go to the footnotes to get that, but I'm just trying to show you the math here. So the after-tax cost of debt would be the weighted average yield to maturity on bonds times 1 minus that tax rate right there. So that's the after-tax cost of debt. Okay, now to get WACC, we just need to execute this formula, and remember we've dropped off preferred stock. So the first thing is we need to take the value of equity over enterprise value. So the value of equity right there over enterprise value, which is the sum of the value of equity and the value of debt. So that right there is the weight that we're going to put against the cost of equity. Okay, so we're going to multiply that weight by the cost of equity. And then we need to add to that the weight of debt, so that's going to be the value of debt divided by enterprise value, which is the sum of the equity and the debt, and that's going to get multiplied against our after-tax cost of debt. We hit the enter button, and we get a WACC, a weighted average cost of capital of 9.46%. So how would you use that weighted average cost of capital? If you were executing a discounted cash flows model to value Southwest Airlines using free cash flows to the firm, that would be your discount rate. Likewise, if you were calculating the net present value of a project for Southwest Airlines, and if the project you perceived had a similar risk profile to the company in general, then you would use this WACC as your discount rate in that NPV calculation. What I really want you to take away from this is that the discount rate is the rate that fully compensates for the risk of the cash flows, and it's the rate that precisely and perfectly captures the opportunity cost. Now, when it comes to rubber meeting the road, it's going to be driven by the claimants, right? Because it's a required return. So that discount rate is the required return to the claimants on the cash flows. If the claimants on the cash flows are shareholders, we used CAPM as our method for estimating the required return. If the claimants on the cash flows are our creditors, we use the weighted average yield to maturity on our bonds. If the claimants on the cash flows are both creditors and shareholders, then we use the weighted average cost of capital, which also takes into consideration the fact that the interest expense gives us a tax shield. Well, look, I know this is a long module. I know it's important though, and I hope you were able to understand what we did. We'll ask clarifying questions and do a lab in class. Main point is now you have what you really need to be successful, because just a final reminder here. Remember we said that really everything hangs on these two equations. But in order to do these equations well, you remember that what it boils down to is you got to get the numerator right and you got to get the denominator right. At this point in the course, now we've talked about both. We've talked about forecasting the cash flows, what stays in and what should be left out. And now today we've talked about what the right discount rate is. So at this point, you're very well equipped to do a DCF model, a dividend discount model, a net present value calculation, a discounted payback period calculation. So we're really making great progress, and I hope you can feel that.